My main contribution, yes, my main contribution of extracurricular time was with the drama, plays. Now, the history of drama at Eton was rather interesting because certainly before the war it was very, very frowned on doing plays. Not just because of the delicate problem of little boys dressed up as girls and the terrible consequences that might follow from that. It was held to make people self-important and all the rest of it. And there was one master famously called Mr. Headley who asked if he could do scenes from Shakespeare. There was to be no scenery, no costume, just Shakespearean words and a few actions. And the vice provost at the time, a man called Rowlatt, said, "The drama is the heart of the arts. I think that settles the matter, Mr. Headley." And poor Mr. Headley actually ruined his Eton career by associating himself with this terrible, terrible activity called drama. Fortunately, the times were changing, and in the 50s, the drama came, and one of the masters called Ralph Paine, both as a boy and then when he returned as a master, managed to put on plays with costumes and scenery. And he was helped by John Barton, who of course later became a very distinguished producer at Stratford. And there were housemasters even. There was a housemaster called Giles St. Albin, who was a rich man, and he had plays which he was able to pay for decent costumes and scenery and all the rest of it. And shortly after I got to Eton, my friend Brian Rees had produced for Giles L'Aiglon, which is a play by Forster. I think it was done in English, certainly, about Napoleon's child, you know. And that was extremely good. And so the drama had begun to move at Eton, although it was still hedged about with, it was obviously that one had to watch one's step. The first invitation to put on was to put on a review, and I only ever did one review because it's hard work doing a review. The housemaster who asked me to come and do it for his boys was Peter Lawrence. And Peter was a maths teacher, and he was a wonderful person because he was one of the old boys who keep a school going. He'd been there for donkey's years, nothing was too much trouble, he knew all about everything, and so forth. And he'd married into the Eton aristocracy. One of the great housemasters of the early 20th century was a man called George Lyttelton, whose son Humphrey was well known as a trumpet player. And Peter was married to Humph's sister, Helena. And these were charming people who became great friends of mine and were great supporters of mine. And Peter asked me if I'd do a review. He said, "Their boys are very keen." That was certainly true. And he said, "And they've got lots of ideas." Well, as I discovered, that was not true. And the problem about doing a review was that I found I had to produce 16 ideas. Well, when you're doing a play, you only got to produce one idea, namely which play you're going to do, and then the rest all follows fairly easily. Whereas with a review, you had to produce 16, but it went well. And I got and we had little musical numbers and all the rest of it. And I made them recite poems. We had dramatized poems. One of Morgan Forster's friends, William Plumer, wrote some very jolly poems, and I did one of them, which was it appeared in the program as the Flying Bomb, but in fact it's actually called the Flying Bum because it's about a flying bomb that lands on a vegetarian guest house. And it goes very well. I'll give you the first verse. "In the vegetarian guest house, all was frolic, feast, and fun. Eager voices are inquiring, 'Are the nettle cutlets done?'" That went over well in a dramatised form. And the closing number I did, oh, the opening of the second half, I'm very fond of Flanders and Swann. And they did the warthog. They did songs about animals. And their warthog is a lovely song because it's about the poor female warthog who tries to be one of the girls and signally fails until a nice gentleman warthog comes along and persuades her that what one has to do is to be true to oneself, to be whatever one is. This important message is sugared by the pill of some very agreeable music and amusing poetry. And we did the war talk, and we had the people with animal masks and all that. That was a bit of a success. And for the closing number, I got hold of the Eton School songs. Now, people all know the boating song. Well, strictly speaking, that's not one of the Eton School songs, because like Harrow, Eton does have an official volume of school songs. Now, the Harrow songs are jolly good. And indeed, one of the features of my life in Cambridge was that I got hold of a copy of it, and at parties sometimes we would sing 40 Years On and others of the Harrow songs. And the Eton songs really aren't in the same class, I'm sorry to say, but I strung together a medley of them. One of them I remember was the Fives song, with its happy message, "So let Fives its lesson teach, hit all balls within your reach." And there was another, I don't know which one I finished with, but there was a sentimental song called "The Old School List," in which an old Etonian is sitting on an office stool sentimentally looking down the list of names of his former companions. What intrigued me about that was the idea that in the 1890s, being on an office stool was regarded as the where old Etonians were aiming. People who think they're all Huey Henrys or whatever it is, or country gents, or riding to hounds, or whatever. Office stool, apparently, was where they all used to go, at any rate, back in the 1890s. So that went well. But fortunately, another housemaster, a couple of years later, asked me, did he ask or did the boys ask? Because a lot of these things were negotiated by the boys. You had to check with the housemaster, of course, but it was all too likely that the boys came to see me and said, would I come and do a play for them? And plays by this stage, a house play, were, it was becoming a matter of rivalries. Oh, Mr. So-and-so's had a very good play, and what can we do? You know, that'll you know, get the réclame from the rest of the school, you see. And I know the sort of plays the boys wanted. They wanted drawing room comedies, and I wasn't, well, it was curious enough, my first play, I suppose, was a drawing room comedy. It was a play that I knew well, and I knew was bound to be a smash hit, and that was The Importance of Being Earnest. Oh, incidentally, in the school play pound, which I've spoken of, there were copies of The Importance of Being Earnest, and the edition they'd got had actually got all the jokes and witticisms removed. I thought, how could anybody bring themselves to emasculate it in this way?